Okay, thank you, Edouard. Thank you for the invitation. So this presentation, yes, it will build quite a lot on the different presentation we had before. So I will go quite fast on some of the slides to gain time. And yeah, just the climax maybe of the presentation will be about the impact of Greenland ice sheet melting that we have heard a little bit in the former presentation. But I've worked quite a lot on that, and there is this nice illustration coming from Stefan Olsen, a Danish colleague who is going regularly to Greenland, and last time it was like that on the ice sheet, so showing that quite nicely how rapidly it's melting at the moment. And Edouard was right. Yeah, we will talk quite a lot on this warming hole that has been already mentioned this morning. And so it's not only a warming hole, we also noticed other signal that might be, can be related with MOC weakening, for instance, a freshening, quite a clear freshening, and also other elements. So it could be a fingerprint of the weakening of the MOC. It's not for sure, it's quite indirect, but a recent study by Lefka Cesar estimates that using climate models that this can be related to a three-sphere drop or about 15% weakening of the MOC. And this is the time series from Lefka Cesar, and what I would like to insist on here is when the weakening started, according to our interpretation, it's around the 1950s, where you have a weakening and then you have a slight recovery in the 90s, 2000s. And as also shown quite extensively, the lessons from the past is showing that there might be some relatively abrupt changes, tipping points in the data from ice cores from Greenland, which is very central here. And these changes, especially the warming events, can be very rapid of the order of a few years or decades. Of course, the MOC is suspected to explain part of this variation, and also what is really fascinating about this large-scale circulation, and that has not been so much described, so I will spend a little bit of time, is about this strong non-linearity of this circulation in response, for instance, to freshwater input in the ocean. And it has been shown very early by Henri Stommel. We have a very simple model, one box for the equator, one box for the pole, approximately, with salinity temperature. And you can just make a budget in these two boxes, and you obtain analytically the following, which is what we call a phase diagram in chaotic theory or dynamical system theory, which is the strength of the overturning depending on the freshwater input in the high latitude and removal evaporation in the tropical area. So this graph is showing you that in fact you can have two different steady states, one active, and if you increase the freshwater input or the hydrological cycle, you can reach this bifurcation point from which you will jump quite rapidly or rapidly in the phase diagram towards another state. And then if you come back later on, if the hydrological cycle is getting more normal, if for instance CO2 is removed, you will not come back at the same point, which means that you have two stable states that can be coexistent. And this is still true in higher resolution model. My point here is that, okay, these are very simple model and that's true, but the mechanisms that are described here will not disappear in more complex model. And what is driving this hysteresis is related to positive feedbacks. The fact that when the AMOC is weakening, you are decreasing the salinity transport towards the high latitude, and as a consequence, you change the gradient, and this is feeding back your changes. And this advective salinity feedback is quite simple, and is still there in very high resolution model, and it has been shown in, even in eddy resolving system, that the AMOC might be still bistable. This might remain true. But I would like to insist on a confusion, maybe in the media, for instance, that this is very fascinating, but this is just steady state. There is no time here. It's just steady state, which means that to reach a steady state, we might need something like a century to millennia. So this is where we might be cautious. But still, a large change of the AMOC is worrying, and Juliette has already shown this picture that we put together within IPCC SROC report. And in fact, it's just based on literature, existing literature, showing all the potential impact of a substantial weakening. By substantial, we were meaning about 50% of weakening or larger. And I would just like here to insist on, of course, we know Europe, that there might be some impact, but some of them might be interesting, let's say. But where it might be more critical is the Sahelian region, where we expect with quite a lot of confidence. You see the confidence is denoted by the number of points. We think that if the AMOC is substantially weakening, we might have a serious drought in this area, with strong decrease in sorgho and millet production, and this might affect millions of people, because there are millions of people living there. The northern part of the Amazon forest might be also at risk in a case of a strong change, and even some teleconnection to the Asian monsoon has been shown, even though the confidence is lower in that case. And I would like also to insist that just this picture is about what is quite confident in the literature. And there is a new paper, for instance, last week about Australian colleagues who do show once again that also a collapse of the AMOC might affect the Niño, the Walker circulation, and so on. So already we have quite large scale impact, but it's just about the literature. And there might be other impacts that are not assessed yet. And for instance, since the report, there are, for instance, this paper, which is quite surprising, I would say, showing that in case of a collapse of the AMOC, using some niche statistical model of the of amphibians, this author do show that there might be a very strong response to the collapse, which is really huge, I should say. And they argue that this is related to a change in seasonality due to the change in the AMOC. So is there any risk? That's a big question. And in IPCC SROC report, we end up with this figure showing that as far as we know, at that time we were saying it's quite unlikely that there will be a collapse at the end of the century. And you can see that for 1.5 degree of warming, the weakening might remain limited, and we need to reach about 4 degrees or 5 degrees before to see substantial weakening with a large enough probability. Nevertheless, there are still this idea that even a low probability event, here it was shown for climate sensitivity, even if there are some high climate sensitivity which has low probability, if their impact is high, and I think the former picture is showing it is, the risk, which is a multiplication of the two, might remain quite high. So that's still something to consider, I would say, even if it's relatively low probability. So, after this introduction, I will touch the following question. The first one is trying to think about what is causing this weakening, if any, over the last century. So, providing a few insights on that. Having also a deep think about the potential impact of Greenland ice sheet melting, and is it well represented in climate models? And then the question about the future and what do we know and what do we do not know about the near future. So this presentation will touch multiple time scale, and I would like here to insist on that it's not the same processes at play. We will look in a little bit into the deeper past at centennial time scale, the decadal for the recent period, and for the future, we will see that there might be multiple time scales. In terms of methods, I will just focus on using data, which are usually more convincing, I would say, than models from a scientific point of view. So instrumental for the recent past, and paleo data, which can really bring something also, and even in terms of knowledge of the future. Of course, the database of climate models, we have more than 40 models available, in for instance, in CEMEP6. And we will see that there are some ideas on how to combine recent observation and models to try to reduce uncertainty, which is called emergent constraint, which is just to say that we will believe more models that are close to present day observation than the other. So let's move to the first question. And so this weakening of the MOC was a bit surprising for the modeling community, let's say, because what we found in terms of response to the external forcing over the historical period is rather a slight increase of the MOC due to anthropogenic aerosols. So what is the forced response if you have a number of different members or models? Here it's different members. The forced response is the ensemble mean. And so the ensemble mean is like that. So you don't see much changes before the 2000s. And there is even a slight increase here, which has been attributed to anthropogenic aerosol and the cooling of the North Atlantic. So the next question is rather what drives the observed cooling in the superpolar gyres? And so then things become quite difficult because it's quite model dependent. There is a publication by Schemke and Zana showing that in one model, in fact, anthropogenic forcing is able to explain the observed cooling. Another one, which we were part of, Rémi Bonnet, so this is this figure, has shown that in fact, to represent this cooling, we need internal variability, and internal variability is able to reproduce it. But in that case, we might have quite a strong weakening of the MOC, which is shown here in blue. And so these are the members of the same models that are in agreement with the temperature in the North Atlantic, and they are showing a weakening of the MOC, as suspected, proposed by Lefkos-Cesar, but it's mainly internally generated. And this is also consistent with a more recent paper by Mojib Latif, showing that at least what is observed in terms of MOC or SST in the subpolar is consistent just with internal or natural variability of the models. So we are not sure yet, and I think we need to use all the models available to know more, but there is a possibility that what is going on is internal. And if it is the case, there are quite some strong consequences, I would say. And this is what we've shown in the Bonnet paper, because as I was mentioning, there was in this large ensemble of members of the same model with different initial conditions, same forcing, that's all the gray line. And here you have global temperature and the observation are in blue and in orange. And in fact, what we found is that the simulation, the most in line with observation, so that's the green one, in fact, were the one that do show a decrease of the MOC for the last 50 years or so. And which, because in this model, it's pretty clear that the internal variation of the MOC are related with trend, the trend in a global temperature. And what we found is that, in fact, the simulation showing a weakening, so the blue one here, are showing so this weakening, which is allowing to get close to the observation as compared to the ensemble mean in black, which is higher. And in the early part, that's what is very surprising and interesting, is that you have an increase of the MOC, internally forced, no forcing here, internally generated, sorry. And it's also in agreement, in fact, with the warming phase that has been observed and that is also simulated in this model, meaning that this warming phase, which is a bit strong as compared to forced response in black, can be explained by this internal variability of the MOC. So the big question then is, in this model, we have this internal variability with a bicentennial variability approximately. Is it realistic? That's the next question, and I don't have answer yet. To come back to the more recent period, and to come back also to illustrate what Pascal has shown this morning, that's true that over the last 50 years, there are no very clear sign of any trend. But this is not in disagreement with what César et al. Are proposing, in fact, because as I have shown you, for the recent period, there was a bump in the late 90s and 2000. So there is no incoherency, I would say, here. And just to mention that for this decadal variability, we proposed that part of this variability at the decadal scale can be related to volcanic eruptions. And we recently found that it's this decadal variability forced by volcanic eruption on top of what is coming from the ENEO, as shown by Juliette this morning. It's still at play in SEMIP6 model. Here is what you can find in the SEMIP6 attribution run. So in blue, just the run with natural forcing, which means volcanic eruption and solar, but solar is very weak. And in fact, if you do peak by peak, it's a little bit by eye, I agree, but it's not totally inconsistent with the observation, and so maybe it might have played a role. This is an hypothesis, but which is supported at least by models and a conceptual model that I would like here to illustrate. So the conceptual model is just that volcanic eruption might excite variability, a 20-year variability, which is a kind of classical timescale in this area. And so after Montagung in 1963, this conceptual model, which is in agreement with numerical model, is proposing that you have a damped oscillation looking like that. The idea is then that you have other strong volcanic eruption like El Chichen in 1982, and in that case, the sum of the two leads to constructive interference, which might explain a big increase in the 90s, late 90s. And finally, you have the Pinatubo eruption in 1991. And in that case, the timing leads to a destructive interference, which might explain that over the recent time, there is not that large variation. And what is interesting is that, in fact, this timing is also in agreement with the Great Salinity anomalies, so there might be a link. So the big part of the presentation is about the Greenland ice sheet melting, and is it well represented, but also can it explain the weakening of the MOC, or is it just only natural? Why I am insisting on that is just because, as mentioned by Gerrit, in fact, Greenland ice sheet melting usually is neglected in models because we don't really know how to model it, or it's a lot of effort. It's not always well modeled, while the observations are showing quite a large amount of melting, or an acceleration at least of the melting. This is what is shown here in the black line. So you see the melting of Greenland and this large acceleration in the 1990s, but also an event in the 1920s. And so above, all in all, you have a kind of increase of this Greenland ice sheet melting. So we've made some simulation, including this observed melting using this Bamber estimate. So we override the runoff, and we also use some calving using just a climatology. This is what is shown here. And we integrate 10 members and even 20 at the end to really be able to isolate the response to this forcing. So here is a propagation of the melting using passive tracer. So you see that little by little the freshwater is going along the subpolar gyre and also little by little towards the Nordic seas and even toward the subtropical gyre part of it. And what is remarkable is that in the middle of the Labrador or in the middle of the Haringer, there are not so many tracers that reach this region. And so we do find a weakening, as expected, which is shown here. But what I would like to insist on is that, in fact, it's very small. It's with 20 members, we estimate it to be 0.2 plus or minus 0.4, almost 0.4 Sverdrup. So very hard to detect, in fact, and far less to the weakening estimated by CESAR. So following this model, we were thinking, okay, the melting of Greenland has nothing to do with what is occurring. And we believe maybe it can be just internally, if any. Then we come back to the same question within Blue Action project, but using another higher resolution model, which is shown here. This is the size of the grid box. So in our low resolution model, it's about 60 kilometers in the high latitude, while in this high resolution model, it's about 2 to 3 kilometers. So this is an ocean-only model because it's very expensive. And we've done the same, some twin simulation, one with melting, the other without. And so this simulation were performed by Christophe Herbeau and Marino Housset, and it was pretty short because it's very CPU demanding. So only 30 years, but we try to compare them with our longer simulation just to see if we see very different things. And yeah, just to show you how it goes in this higher resolution model. So you see the anomalies of salinity every year. And so you see that quite rapidly, in fact, it is reaching the center of the Labrador Sea, which is quite different from what we obtain in our low resolution model. And this is what can be seen here, the salinity anomalies over the whole simulation in the higher resolution model. It's here, the low resolution models. So you can think, okay, it's quite similar, but in fact it's not, because if you look at the scale, it's one order of magnitude of difference. In fact, here you have very strong freshening along the current, the very thin current around Greenland, and at the center you have also one order of magnitude stronger freshening. And as a consequence, the mixed layer depth anomalies in the Labrador Sea is also far stronger than what we can find in the low resolution model. Once again, what is important here, in fact, is the scale. Here you have 500 meters weakening of the mixed layer depth, and the mean state is about 1,000, and here you just have 50 meters. And as a consequence, you also can find very different response for the AMOC, here shown in density space at different places, the OSNAP array at 45 degrees north, and all of them are showing that you have on a very short time scale a weakening due to Greenland melting, mainly due to Greenland melting of up to 2 Sverdrup, so almost one order of magnitude more. So this is quite questioning, and why is it so? We hypothesize that this might be partly related to the eddies, and if you look at the eddies in this region, you can see that the eddy kinetic energy has very strong activity in the Labrador Sea, while not much in the Haringer Sea in this model. And this might be related to the bathymetry and to gradient. And this means that here you have lots of eddies that can bring the salinity anomalies from the border current, continental current, towards the center. And so we produce this little scheme just to try to be clear on what we believe has happened. It's mainly an hypothesis, let's say. So in low resolution, we have this type of scheme with the continental current around Greenland and the convection side here in violet. In high resolution, the current are thinner and as in reality, which means about 10 kilometers in section. And so we are melting the Greenland, and as a consequence, this is reaching this continental current. And since the current are thinner in the high resolution, the dilution is stronger. And then also the fact that you have very strong eddy-kinetic energy is bringing more freshwater toward this central area, which is leading to the larger weakening of the Labrador Sea convection that we formed. So this is a bit annoying, I would say, but at least we cannot totally discard the effect of Greenland over the recent period, even though here it's pretty short, it's far from perfect, but at least it's quite concerning. What about the future? So the question of is IMOC moving towards the tipping point, and what type of change can we expect, let's say? So just to say that IMOC collapse is possible in some models. Here is, for instance, what we found during my PhD. In fact, it was a 2x CO2 simulation of 500 years. And if you include or not the Greenland ice sheet melting, you clearly cross a threshold. In one case, you are coming back, in fact, even with stronger state, and in the other case, you can collapse. And the impact was here more about a moderation, let's say, of the warming in the North Atlantic. But yeah, we also showed this strong impact in terms of precipitation in the tropics, which might be the most worrying effect. So to know if we might get closer to such a point, there is dynamical system theory, which tell us that approaching from a tipping point in simple model, at least, the variation, the recovery to perturbation is getting longer and longer. In fact, that has been shown in a model to be true. In fact, before a collapse, you observed an increase of the variability, but it was also shown that you need at least 250 years of observation to be able to evaluate that. Recent paper with only the 150 years of instrumental data argue that maybe we are approaching such a tipping point, but it was a bit short. It was using also fingerprints. And it was not really tested in a pseudo-proxy approach. Just to mention that we also looked into these IDs, but using longer term frame and using a Pages2K database with lots of data on the continent and in the ocean. And we used a statistical tool to try to reconstruct the variability modes. Here the IMV, which is well-known fingerprint, potential fingerprint at least of the AMV, or at least it's related in models. So the idea here is just to use these large scale proxy records and one climate index, and using quite advanced statistical reconstruction, here the random forest approach, we can reconstruct the climatic index in the past. And so what we've done using all this archive for the IMV, and this is the blue curve shown here. And what is remarkable is that we confirm the result from Bowers with a very clear increase of variability over the recent period in this internal variability, since we reconstruct just the internal variability. So it's questioning us, but once again, keep care of the time scale. And what are the models telling us, the semi-psychs models, and it has been shown before, what we can expect for the end of the century is more something like 6 to 8 Sverdrup of weakening, but without including Greenland ice sheet melting, which is neglected here. And what is also striking is a spread. I mean, you have a spread in terms of percent of about 20 to 80% of weakening. So which models do we need to believe? That's kind of a big question. And so to face that, IPCC statements were quite cautious. What they argue is that the MOC will very likely weaken because almost all the models are showing a weakening. That's something that is clear. The magnitude of the weakening is difficult to assess, and there is low confidence. It's not a good estimate to just take the mean because the variability is huge, the spread is huge. And they also added quite a new statement saying that there is medium confidence that there will not be an abrupt collapse. And why so? Because as shown also by Anne-Marie this morning and shown here for Greenland ice sheet melting, there are crucial processes that are missing in those models. And for the moment, most of those processes are rather leading to larger sensitivity than stabilization, let's say. So we are not very sure. And this uncertainty is key, I would say, as shown in this study by Bellomo. Why is it key? Because it's explaining a very large amount of uncertainty in the future. So here is SEMIP 5 model, SEMIP 6 model, response to 4 times CO2, and so you see that the spread is even larger in the new generation of models. And as a consequence, it's leading to very large uncertainty in what will go on in the North Atlantic in terms of temperature. In terms of precipitation, it's bringing lots of uncertainty in the high latitude, but also in the tropical area, and not only in the Atlantic. And it's even affecting where the jet stream will be positioned. And depending on the weakening, the shift of the jet stream can change a lot, and the storminess as well. So this was mainly for the MOC, but we also were interested in recent time on a subsystem, which is a subpolar gyre, where you have convection in the Labrador and Hemingway Sea. So just subsystem of the ocean circulation, the North Atlantic ocean circulation. And in place of looking at the weakening of the MOC, we just looked at the cooling. The cooling of SST, which is shown here, so it was in SEMIP5, and we looked into different models. We scanned the world SEMIP5 database, and we end up by three different types of models. Models showing just warming, that was a majority, like 30 models showing just kind of a warming, or at least no abrupt changes, because we were searching for this type of event. A change in SST in one decade larger than 4 standard deviation or 3 standard deviation from the pre-industrial, so something very big. And so we found 7 models in SEMIP5 showing this type of event, and 2 models showing even stronger events, and these events were mainly driven by a collapse of the MOC. While here it was more related with a large change in mixed layer depths in the subpolar gyre. So this is true. This was true in SEMIP5. It's still the case, but with a bit less models in SEMIP6. But we still do find some models showing quite rapid changes in temperature in the subpolar. And next question was: okay, we can find such event in some models, but is it realistic? These models are maybe just outliers or something going wrong. And so that's why we looked into their ability to reproduce the SPG stratification. So the stratification, which is a key element, in fact, in terms of convection, depending on the fact that you have stratification, a good stratification or not, you can have a convection or not. And so this is what is shown here. In red is the observed stratification in the subpolar gyre, And you see that lots of models are very too strongly stratified. This is for SEMIP 6. This was also true for SEMIP 5. And in fact, the models showing abrupt changes are usually here. It's a blue one for SEMIP 6. They are pretty closer to the observation than most of the other models. And in fact, this stratification can be even used as an emergent constraint to see if what will be the trend of SST in this subpolar gyre. The closer to zero, the better is represented the present day stratification. And you see in blue the abrupt change models. And there is a kind of quite linear relationship showing that models showing very large warming in this subpolar are very too strongly stratified usually. And so we end up using this emergent constraint by a kind of quantification based on those model and observation of stratification to a risk of having such a change, rapid change in one decade of a few degrees of 36 to 45 in the high end, let's say, of risk. So which is far from negligible. So do we matter about that? And so to illustrate this, we've analyzed one of the VOS models that has been downscaled using Cordux model. And it was showing this very cooling event of one decade once again. And then there was a recovery. That was the Australian model. And so we looked into this decade as compared to the decade before. And we can see that the difference in temperature over Europe is quite strong. In fact, it's about more than 1 degree. And if you look at the ensemble mean for a scenario where you can imagine that if you look at the forced response, normally you should have a warmer and warmer temperature. And we just look into viticulture because this was done in Bordeaux, so that's a big deal over there. And the idea with viticulture is that the warmer the climate is getting, the norther you can cultivate vineyard, Vinis vitifera. And for instance, in England at the moment, more and more people are trying to cultivate Vitis vinifera to produce some wine. And what we showed here is that, in fact, if you have such an event during 10 years, in all the red points here, is the area where you might be able to cultivate Vitis vinifera at that time, the decade before. But during the cold decade, there will be almost no production at all. So which means that, yeah, such instabilities, which they might be quite difficult for our adaptation plans, and I will argue that I am not sure that they are really accounted for at the moment. So are we close to such an event? So once again, for the subpolar gyre, to try to answer this question, we looked into the models showing this abrupt event just before they collapse. And so we end up with a critical, what we named a critical stratification, which is the black line with the spread, because there was different model. And we just draw the observation for the Great Salinity anomalies and for present day. And so the conclusion there was not very strong, just to say that maybe we are not that far because the envelope are overlapping. So there might be potential. So to our idea to have early warning signal of such event with all the best knowledge that we have at the moment might be to redevelop this decadal prediction, which means starting from an observed state of the ocean as much as possible and then using model to evaluate what is going on in the next decade. And so we are working on that, but there are some research gaps. And first of all, yeah, observation systems can be efficient early warning, but we need to continue what is done at the moment and maybe include more oceanic observation below 2,000 meters to be able to initialize correctly the deep ocean. And this decadal prediction system they need to make some progress in terms of offset to observation, because it's difficult to assimilate observation in some systems which have strong biases. And also, we might try to think on how to include the mesoscale that might play a big role, as shown in Anne-Marie's presentation also here. And I was hoping that maybe a parameterization might help, because or else I'm not sure we might be able to make large ensemble with very high resolution simulation. And I will argue that reconstruction of the last thousand of years are still very useful and can be helpful to in terms of dynamical system theory to confirm if we are approaching any tipping points. And I will also insist on the fact that such low probability high impact scenario are poorly accounted for up to now in our adaptation plans. So to conclude, I will say that the ongoing changes in the MOC and the SPG are not clearly attributed yet. It remains model dependent, so we might need to work a bit more on that. Just to say that there is a possibility of rapid change in the North Atlantic in IPCC type models. The time scales are crucial. It might be very long for the MOC. Usually it takes about a century, at least in present day models. Well, it can be quite rapid for the subpolar gyre subsystem. And both events are quite strong impact regionally, but there is also teleconnection to account for. And just to insist on that, decadal prediction might be the efficient tool to have early warning of such potential changes, and that we might think on how to include such event in our adaptation plans. So thank you for your attention.